So I continue chapter 3 and about alternative tableau and the bijection with permutation coming from the representation of a representation of the PASEP algebra. So I just remind you what we have done in chapter 3a, just a short summary of the previous lecture. So we have introduced the PASEP model in physics with 5 parameters. Then I introduce the matrix on that, where 2 matrix D and E satisfy this equation, fundamental equation defining the PASEP quadratic algebra with some border condition. Then the P tableau, the Q tableau associated to this algebra was the alternative tableau. This is a complete alternative tableau. And then from the directly using the matrix on that and the normal ordering in the quadratic algebra, we get from this normal ordering in the quadratic algebra, any words in E and D can be rewritten like this. The summation is over all possible alternative tableau or complete alternative tableau. And you just change the E and D in the probability border condition, and you get immediately what is called a stationary probability of the model. So I want to have a representation of this PASEP algebra to get a bijection between the alternative tableau and permutation in the same spirit as we get the RSK bijection with the representation with operator U and D satisfying the Weyl-Heisenberg algebra. So I introduce some operator acting. The vector space is generated by the basis is integer, and I have 4 operators, A, S, A for adjunction of a particle, S for suppression, and 2 operators J and K arcing questions. So this motivation, this idea, comes from data structure in computer science. It's more complete than the motivation from quantum mechanics with annihilator and cancellation operator. So if I have these 4 operators, they satisfy if you call D equal A plus K, E equal S plus J, and they satisfy this quadratic equation. In fact, I make a small mistake last time because I was too much influenced by quantum mechanics notation. And because we write the operator from left to right as a word, so I should write this way. The action of the operator U, which is a product as a word, on the state K. So I am going to prove this, give a proof of this. So operator D, which is this plus this. This is D A plus K. So if you are in state K, you go to state K plus 1 with a coefficient K plus 1. You go to state K, you stay at the same level. From K, you go to K with a coefficient in front of the vector K plus 1. And E is coefficient the operator J, is J plus S with coefficient K and K. See what I mean here? It's the coefficient in front of the vector. It will be in the bijection with, I am going to show it will be some number of possibilities in the data structure, number of possibilities to add a new element or to add question. In Laguerre history, I'm going to introduce today, it will be the number evaluation on the path, on the Botkin path. But here, you see, it's just, you can check this equation. So operator D is the D of a vector K is the sum of these 2 vectors. It's K plus 1 times the vector K plus K plus 1 times the vector K plus 1. Operator E acting on vector K will give you K times the vector K. And k times the vector chi minus 1. So if you just do dE, so combine these 2, d, this is d multiplied by e, plus, and this is, so this gives you all this coefficient. If you are at level k or the vector k, this will give you the sum of these 3 vectors, k plus 1, k, and k minus 1, with this coefficient in front of the vector. If you compute ED from this simple diagram, you will get this. And if you compute DE minus ED, you will get this. It's just some vector, some operator acting on the basis, the vectors are integer, and there's a coefficient in front of it, which is k, k minus 1, or k plus 1. So if you make this simple computation, so this is d, this is e, and if you you take d plus e, the sum of all this is exactly the same as this. And so you get the proof of this equation. So in fact, I will not use, in this lecture, I will not use this operator. I will use a slightly different operator, which are the following. So I will use again with the same notation four operators A, S, J, and K, satisfying this condition. If any of these four operators is acting on vector K, this will give K plus 1. Oh, no, I am wrong. This will be K plus 1 time. And if it's operator A, it will be K plus 1. If it's operator S, this will be K minus 1. And if it's operator J or K, this will give you K. So here is the correct definition. So you are at level K. Operator A, you increase at level K plus 1. From K, you go to K plus 1 with coefficient K plus 1. If you act with K or J, you will stay at the same level. K go to K with coefficient K plus 1 again. And if you go down, deleting an element, you go from level K to level K minus 1. Coefficient again will be K plus 1. So it's in large operator, in the data structure in dictionary, when you add a negative question, there is K plus 1 way to ask a negative question if you have K element. But when you delete an element, there's only K element. So the number of ways to delete an element is coefficient is K. Here, I will take K plus 1. This may be strange. So in fact, instead of adding, deleting particle or element of the data structure, I am adding or deleting interval between the particle. So it's strange to say, OK, I am going to add or delete an interval, which is the absence of particle. There is no particle. So deleting an interval, what it means? It means adding a particle. So you will have a better vision. So even if I take this equation, so you may be, okay, it's strange that all these four operators, they satisfy, they have the same coefficient in front. But if you took the same kind of computation as before, d minus ed will be exactly e plus d. And the previous operator, I will call this a restricted operator, when I have only coefficient with k plus 1, k plus 1, k, and k. Here, coefficient will be k plus 1, k plus 1, k plus 1, k plus 1 everywhere. But this is too abstract to make a representation. I need some more. So I will introduce commutative object where the k, k minus 1, k plus 1 will make better sense. So notation, when you have a V, a vector space, an operator from V to V, then I will take the quantum mechanics notation. If you have a vector V, an operator A is acting on V, so this is the notation. And if you have a basis and you take a vector V0, so this notation means the coefficient of V when you expand V on the basis, coefficient on the vector V0. And so this notation means you have the operator A. It's starting acting on the vector V0, and you try to find the coefficient of V0. So now I'm going to make more precise, more concrete for combinatorics to get really a representation of the E and D with four operators. So instead of acting on integer, k, k minus 1, k plus 1, a certain coefficient, or instead of adding, deleting element in the data structure, I introduce the following. It's more concrete. So the vector space has a basis B. The basis is alternating words on two letters with no occurrence of white, white, and no occurrence of black, black. So this means, imagine in data structure, you have a sequence of elements. They are totally ordered. So the elements are the black ball. And between two black balls, there is an interval, which is the white ball. And maybe there is an interval at the beginning, an interval at the end. So if you have k elements, there is k plus one interval. So I denote this by alternating words with no occurrence of black-black and no occurrence of white-white.
But that just means it's either white-black, white-black, or...
Yeah, yeah, yes.
Nothing else.
Nothing else. It's a stupid, stupid vector space where the dimension of all the words of Lensen, there is only two words. Let's make the things more simple. But it's better to write like this than to say, OK, I take the basis to be integer k. Here you have two words of length k, depending if you start with a white or with a black. So, but intuitively, it means if I go back to computer science with a data structure, it means that there is k black ball, k element, and then there is some interval, k plus one interval. But maybe in the bijection, I will do its permutation. Maybe sometimes some interval will be closed. They will disappear. So you will see it's more convenient to work with alternative words than just to an integer k, as I was doing at the beginning of the lecture. Of course, you can get a proof with this small green path and k plus 1, k minus 1. I get a proof that d equal d plus. But to have a representation, I need this. So now I define four operators, A, S, J, and K, in the following way. So this four operator is operator A. So you start from a word U, alternating word, and then you take the sum of all the words you can get from this word U by replacing, you take any letters white or any interval, and you replace it by this, which means intuitively you have your sequence of white ball and black ball, your sequence of element. In an interval, you add a new element, the black ball, and you keep. So you split your interval in two, and there is an interval on the left, an interval on the right. Operator S is again the sum of all the possible words. And you replace a white ball by a black ball, which means that if you'd seen in data structure, you have your sequence of elements, you choose one of the intervals, and you put a ball inside. But your interval disappeared. When you put the black dot, the new element, you don't open new interval on the left, new interval on the right. You close completely the interval. Doing this means the interval was between two black balls, maybe. You put your new element, so you have three black balls consecutive. And the rule is that three black balls consecutive is reduced to only one.
So it's the same as just merging two black balls into.
Yes, it's the same as merging. So this is what I say to intuitive idea to suppress an interval. Suppressing an interval, you add a new element inside,
but
a black ball.
At the end. White could be at the end.
White can be. Yes, yeah. It can
in
be at the beginning, at the end, yes.
In just case, it's just removing.
Yeah, yes.
In that case, it is just removing.
Yeah.
Not merging.
Yeah. So, say intuitively, this four operator, I have a sequence of interval and element. I am putting a new element in one of the intervals. And then there is four possibilities. I can open two new intervals at the left and the right. Or open only one on the left or on the right, or open nothing. So I close like the operator S. I don't open any. And operator J and K, you see, you replace a white ball by this. So you are in this interval, you put a new element, this one, and you open a new interval at the right. Or here, you put a new element here, and you open a new interval at the left. So this is the way in data thinking in data structure, see, to put a new element in interval, and there is four possibilities if you close completely the interval or open new interval at the left or on the right, or there is four possibilities. And for example, if you take this sequence of interval black, interval black, you suppress. The suppression is so you put your ball, you can put the ball at the beginning. This replaces suppression. The white is replaced by this black ball, plus there is two possibilities. You put your new element here, the black, and you don't open any new interval on the left or on the right. So you have three black balls consecutive, and this gives you this. So So you see, now it makes sense, this four operator. With the intuition comes from computer science or quantum mechanics. And instead of working with adding, deleting particle, I am adding, deleting interval. So I am, the philosophy is the absence of particle. Maybe it's antimatter. It's the absence of particle. And to delete the absence of particle, it's adding a particle. I don't understand what you say, but now I define D equal A plus J, E equal S plus K, and I claim that D equal ED plus E plus D. I have a representation of the quadratic algebra, but Ferrer, for the RSK Ferrer diagram, I was adding, deleting a cell in a Ferrer diagram. Here I am adding or deleting interval in a sequence of interval, black dot, interval, black dot. So the elements are completely trivial. It's alternating world. And I am doing four operations on this with the intuition of a computer science or quantum mechanics. So I am going to give you the proof. So let's start with AS. A sequence of A followed by S. So here is my word. Now I change the notation. Instead of white ball, I put in like interval, you see. So this is part of the world, of the alternative world, U, V, W, and I am inside the world. And suppose I am acting the operator A on this position. There's many different ways to put the A. So I do the A, and then on this position, I do the S. So this gives me this. Now, if you just reverse, start from S, and then you do A. So you feel there is a commutation. AS, in that special case, is going to be the same as acting SA. But now there is a special case when first you do A, and then on one of the new intervals, which is created by doing A, you make S acting on it. And I claim that this is exactly the same as starting from this and doing the J operator. J means you put a ball in the interval and you add a new interval on the right. And the claim is that these are the same because black, black equals black. I keep this, I did not reduce black, black to show you that equivalence. It's not exactly the same word, but they are equivalent. And there will be another case also. You start with A, and then instead of the left cell, you do it on the right cell, which is added, created. Then you do the operation S. So this gives you this word. And doing now operator K on the same position. U and V is a sequence of black and interval. So I am acting on the same position. This gives me this. And so they are the same. So these three pictures in three different cases give you a proof of this equation.
And it's a bijective proof.
Yes, it's important. This is going to be the commutation diagram. The local rules are here. The local rules are appearing for my bijection. Analog of local rule for me for Ferrer diagram. Instead, I am working with alternative world. So these three pictures convince you that AS equals SA plus J plus K.
First picture.
Yes, this one?
Yes. When you apply S.
Here.
So that won't, I mean, this won't remain V and W, right? Because
if I apply S, wait, here, here.
Yes, yes.
Here. So if this means, this gives you V point W?
No, but I mean, the last letter of V was the black circle.
Yes.
So that will merge together, right?
Yes.
And the
yes.
first letter of W is a black circle.
Yeah. Yes. Yes. Yes.
Together.
Yes. There should be some reduction.
Yeah.
I am working with the full world without reduction. I don't claim that. There will be a reduction.
But
here.
You get the same thing from below. Or not.
But even without reduction, I have the same thing. Here, I don't have the same things, so I need to do the reduction. I don't claim that this is the only possible reduction. It depends on the here. You are right here, V and W, there will be some reduction. But at least with I'm keeping the complete world without any reduction, without knowing how is U, V, W, And I just need to do this reduction. So this is important because you see the reduction, these two kinds of reduction will be related to the blue and red cell of the alternative tableau. When I have this, I will have an exchange. I will have the Q analog in the alternative tableau. I will have the exchange. And here I will have exactly the blue and the red cell will appear. I just give you a flavor, but we will see that this is related. So let's do a Mano AK. So it's maybe boring. I have eight different Ks, but this is exactly the same philosophy. AK in that case is the same as KA. And even here, you see, because you have to be careful. When you add a new interval, apply an operator on the new interval. If I apply K here, then again, I will have the same. So these two cases, in fact, are the same. AK and KA commute here in that case. Adding K on the right of this new interval, it's in the same case as this one. But if I add K in the left interval, then I have something different. I have the same action, AK equal A. So I have these two picture, in fact, is the only one. And I have AK equal KA plus A. So this is two new case. So sometimes you have just a commutation. This will be the Q analog. And sometimes I have a single letters, which will be the blue or the red cell of the alternative tableau. So another case, JS. So I'm going to just check. You will repeat everything. And this is the proof that JS equals SJ plus S. And the last of the eight different cases is this, JK. Anywhere you put your cell is equal to KJ. So if you look carefully at all these diagrams, they are important because this is a local rule. This will be the commutation diagram to construct the bijection in the same spirit as the RSK. So I approve this four equation for the four operator. And I claim that putting E equals this. So by the way, D means J, what adding on the, I don't remember if you had the, J was, K, you had a cell on the left. So this means you are adding a white cell on the left, any of these two operators. And here you are not adding a white cell on the left. Here you are adding a white cell on the left. And here you are not adding a white cell on the left. So this can be a distinction between D and E.
Because D is white goes to black white.
D. Here you're adding a white cell on the left. Here you're adding a white cell on the left. But here you don't add a white cell on the left. And here you don't add a white cell on the left. So this can be a distinction between D and E. To put together A and J, to put together S and K.
The definition of J and in J, you are adding a black cell.
No, it's a white cell on the right. I am.
Ah, yes.
I am always confused with J and K. So, J, I am adding a white cell on the right.
And A also, you're adding.
And A also, I am adding a white cell on the right. But K, I am not adding a white cell on the right. And S, I am not adding a white cell on the right.
Yes.
So this can be a distinction. So the proof that DE satisfies the quadratic algebra with D and E defined like this. The proof is just check from the previous system of four equations with four operators. Just check everything and you get elementary calculus from the four previous equations. So I claim. That D and E, this operator D and E, I call this in large, because D and E satisfy our operator if you have K plus K element. So again, it's wrong. It's according, you go to K or K minus 1 or K plus 1 with K plus 1 weight, K plus 1 possibility. But I claim that I have this, now the permutations are appearing. I claim that if I take d plus e power n, so all possible word w of length n, I claim that starting from the cell single interval, going back to a single interval, I claim that I have exactly total number of such a word I will get is n plus 1 factorial. And I claim that if I take the restricted DNE, which means I have only this coefficient, I will get n factorial. So it was the first operator I introduced at the beginning. Coming from the dictionary data structure, I get n factorial. I call this restricted. It will be restricted bijection. And the full bijection, large, is when instead of the same diagram, but you have k plus 1 everywhere. So instead of k in k, you have k plus 1, k plus 1. So we will work with this, with a large history. It's going to be Laguerre bijection. And the restricted is just you make some restriction in the bijection. But it's useful to have also the second. So the basic element now is Laguerre history. This is the basic element to prove that I get n plus 1 factorial. Previous equation, to prove this, I need to introduce Laguerre history. This is the basic element, basic bijection. So this was done 2 years ago in the lecture about the n factorial garden. So this is a basic bijection. And for the PASEP, for many things in combinatorics, many different, completely different. For example, we gave a proof of the number of Baxter permutation 2 years ago using this bijection. And this will be the key to do everything we want to do is representation of the PASEP algebra. And this is a key bijection to work with the combinatorial theory of orthogonal polynomial. By using this bijection, you can combinatorially prove many moments, what we call the moments of some orthogonal polynomial. Most of the classical orthogonal polynomial, the proof comes from this bijection. So this will be the class next year about combinatorial theory of orthogonal polynomial. So definition of a Laguerre history. Laguerre history is a pair gamma, C, and F. So what is gamma, what is C, what is F? So gamma is a Motzkin pass. You start from this point. You go up and down. You go to the northeast or southeast or level. And you stay always above the zero level, and you finish in this point. So we say the Motzkin pass. It's of length n. Motzkin means because the number of such paths of length n is a Motzkin number. And if you have no level, then the path is of length 2n, and this is the Catalan number, the Dieck path. So what means C? C means I am going to put two colors on the horizontal step, blue and red. So this is also a classical object in the Catalan garden. Such two-color Motzkin paths are enumerated by the Catalan number Cn plus 1. There is a bijection between two-color Motzkin paths and the Dieck path. I have to go back to the first part of the class, but I don't need to use this, but two-color Motzkin paths are Catalan number. So here is gamma C. And now to gamma C, I'm going to associate F, the function F. So first, I am going to put some weight on the northeast step, the two possible steps, the southeast step. The weight will be k plus 1, k plus 1, k plus 1, k plus 1. So intuitively, this corresponds to adding the operator A. When you add a particle, the number of particles in your number of black dots is exactly the level in the path. Adding a new particle, you go up. Doing the operator J and K, you stay at the same level. Number of particles is k. And when you delete, when you suppress the operator s, you go back down to k minus 1. And the number of ways to add, delete, or doing this operation j and k asking question, number of ways to do it is exactly all these coefficients which are here. But I just need to pass the weighted path. So see, this AK, B prime K, B, this is the weight on the path. The weight means that you're in each elementary step, you put the yellow number, 1, 2, 3, you look, the yellow number are exactly this weight given by AK, B prime K, B double prime K, and CK. K is the level of the path, like this. Here I am at level 2. And going down, I put the weight C index 3, no, C index 2, K equal 2. I am going down, so the weight is 3. So the yellow number, you see, for each elementary step, yellow number is K plus 1 if you start the elementary step at level K. So this is called weighted path. When you have a path, for each elementary step, you have a certain weight, which is given by these four possible valuation. And the weight depends only on the level. And the weight is the same for all possible, the four possible paths. It's exactly K plus 1. So this is weighted path. And now what is F? F is called the choice function. It's a vector, P1, P2, PK. For each elementary step, you are going to define the blue number. The blue number is between 1 and the maximum possible is the weight of the elementary step. So you take any choice, the choice function, any numbers pi, p for number of possibility, but intuitively you have a path, you have a weighted path, and you put a second weight, the blue weight, any choice of numbers between 1 and the maximum possible is the level k plus 1. So see, once you have a two-column skill path, which is enumerated by Catalan number, there is many possible valuations. So the total number of possibilities for a given two-column skill path, total number of possibilities to put the blue number is exactly the product of the yellow number. It's the product of all this weight. So and intuitively, this corresponds to the concept of history. In data structure, you remember there is a you are going to perform a certain operation. There's four possible operations, adding a new element, deleting an element, asking question, positive or negative question. So the yellow number corresponds to the size of your data structure, and the blue number corresponds to which choice you are going to do. If there is K element, which one you are going to delete. So you number them from left to right, and then you say, okay, I am deleting the second, the third, the fourth. So your blue number means you remember what you have done. This is called an history. History, it's a sequence of primitive operation. So it's four possible, or a sequence of elementary step in the path. Number of possibilities to perform the operation is a yellow number, is the weight of each elementary step. And the blue step, you say which one you have to. So you remember all you have done in your data structure. Or if you think of adding, deleting particle, or adding with this blue and white ball, you remember everything when you do the operator A, J, K, S. You remember each time what you have done. Which one you, where did you put your S? Where did you, A was acting? And I start from the empty set, so only one interval, and I finish with only one interval. And the claim is that if I take the sum of all the weight of all this total number of the star means I am weighting the path with the blue numbers. So for each path, there is the product of all the total possibility for blue number is the product of the yellow numbers. So this gives me the valuation star. And if I take the sum of the weight of all such paths, this gives me n plus 1 factorial. Total number of Laguerre history of length n is n plus 1 factorial. Let's check to really understand what it means. It means here you have four possible Motkin paths. Now I put a two color on each level. And so this gives me the weight. Now the weight is for each elementary step, if I am at level k, it's k plus 1. So the yellow number, here the yellow number, here is 2, this is 2. This is 2 multiplied by 2. The level is 1, so k plus 1 is 2. There is 2 colors. So you see this is a total weighted for each Motkin path. There is a color weight, 2, and also the k plus 1, the height of the starting. So the total is 24. So I am going to prove this in general by giving a bijection. Giving a bijection between Laguerre history and permutation. So I will describe, 2 years ago, it can be described in different ways with trees and including binary. I will describe this with world because we are acting with operator acting on world. So here is a bijection. So here is a Laguerre, it's a pass. And I start with one interval here. Okay, do the first step. I am going up, means I am putting a one. This is the first step. So it's like putting a black ball in my interval and adding two new intervals on the left and on the right. It's operator A. I am going up, so the possibility is one, the weight is one. They don't see. No, I make a mistake. Okay. So second step, you are at the red level, at level one. So red means I am putting the two. The blue number is two. I am putting the two in the second position, and red level means I am adding a new interval on the left. Red or blue correspond to operator J and K. So the three, there is two possibilities. The yellow number is two. There is two interval, two possibilities to put the three. And I put it in the second position. So I put it here. And I am going up, means I am adding an interval on the left, interval on the right. The four, I have three possibilities. I take the first possibility, the blue number one. So you are putting the four here. And now I am going down. So I don't add any new interval on the left and on the right. So this is the process. You continue like this. Each time going up or down, each time there is four possible step, which correspond to four possible operator. You put your element in one of the intervals. The number of interval is exactly the yellow number, the number of possible choice. You choose, you say which interval you put. And then according to the four possible steps, you add two new intervals left and right, or only one, or you delete. And going to this, at the end, I have started with one empty interval. I finish with one empty interval. And where is the permutation? Well, I have a hole here, so I add a new element, the maximum 9, and I get a permutation on n plus 1 element. And this is a bijection. Any permutation, I can go back. There is a bijection between. So this is a permutation on n plus 1 element. And the reverse bijection, if you take a permutation, you get back, so to reverse it, first, you need to introduce, when you have a permutation like this, you introduce. So I introduce the up-down sequence of the permutation, the rises and the descent, but I introduce something more. I introduce notion of valley, peak, double rise, double descent. So convention, I put a zero at the beginning, a zero at the end. So the peak, you see, it's a succession of a rise followed by a descent. So the two values on the left and on the right of the peak are less. So, and the peak is the value. And the peak is here, 4, 9, 8, 5. And usually the trough is when you a value which is separated. On the left is bigger, on the right is bigger. So here are the trough of the valley of the permutation. And the double rise, 6 is a double rise, is going up and up. And 2 is a double descent, with the convention that zero at the both end of the. So if I go back to my weighted dig pass, if I go back to the permutation, so here is the permutation I get by the bijection with Laguerre history. And you can see that the peak, the trough, and the double rise, double descent, the peak are 4, 5, 8, 9, the valley are 1, 3, 7, double descent 2, double rise 6. This corresponds exactly to the four possible steps of the permutation, of the path. A peak corresponds to going down, a valley corresponds to going up, and the double rise, double descent corresponds to these two blue and red. So the value, the value, for example, 9 is a 9 is a special, but 8 is the peak because step number 8 was going down. Or when you go up, yeah, the step number 3 was going up, so 3 is a valet, is a 12. So you can check this that. So if you know the permutation, first the reverse bijection, you know the permutation, so I can define the Motkin path and the color on the step. Now I have to define the choice function, the blue numbers, which possibility I took for each elementary step. So to get back the blue numbers, which choice I made, so I have to define what is called sometimes the X decomposition of an element X in a permutation. So suppose you have a permutation written as a word, permutation on n element, and you take an element X, the value. X is somewhere, element X is somewhere in your world. And then I can split my permutation in blue and red factor. So in blue, that all the letter of each this word is strictly less than X. The red factor of sigma is all the letters bigger or equal to X. You just separate, you see, when you see your sequence of letters, which one are really above X, which one are below X. And maybe the extreme word V1, V2, Vk, maybe, maybe the blue on both sides can be empty. But all these words are non-empty. So example, you see, example, I take this permutation, X equals 3. So just X3 is here. So I just separate. All the block, the red block are all the letters. So it's a maximum factor in the length, which are all the letters are bigger or equal to 3. And in blue, all the letters are strictly less than 3. Maybe it's empty words at the beginning. Maybe this is not empty, this is 2. The visualization of this is this. Your permutation is like this diagram. You take the value X, and the red part are all the letters above. And X is included in one of these red, and blue are all the letters below. And then the reciprocal bijection tell you, okay, X is one of these V1, V2, V. So this is going to give me the possibility I made in the bijection. So the possibility is the following. So you have your permutation. We have seen that we can define the two-color Motkin path, and then at the step number I, the possibility pi in this sequence is equal to j if and only if I is a letter of vj in the I decomposition of a sigma. I go back to my example here. So I claim that 3 is in the second block, so the possibility for 3 was 2. So the possibility for 3, see, the blue number is 2 here, so this is exactly the 3 belongs to V index 2. So V pi in that case equal j. So forth, because the blue number is 2, and I am the second block. So this is a classical parameter permutation, which is involved in the Q analog of the PASEP, in the crossing. This is an important parameter. That pi of j, you also define by the following way. J is 1 plus the number of triple a, b, I, having this pattern in the permutation. So what does it mean? Pattern 3, 1, 2. It means that you have 3 values. This is the minimum value. This is the second term. This is the third. And 3 and 1, these two values are consecutive. So a pattern like this is an important subject. Permutation is a forbidden pattern. You have triple four letters in a certain way. For example, 1, 2, 3 is a forbidden pattern. 1, 2, 3 is a Catalan number. 2, 1, 3 is a Catalan number. But when you put you put the two letters consecutive means that these two letters must be consecutive. So I claim that I can also define pi of j as a number of such patterns, such triple, and here, for example, it's a. You see, this index j is exactly the number of such patterns. 3, 1, 2. It's because such patterns occur exactly when you go from a red word to a blue one. This is the value 3. This is the 3, the two elements 3 and 1, and this is element 2. So the number of such patterns is exactly the number of such green steps, which is exactly the index v of j. So you can define also, instead of having the x decomposition, by the number of such patterns on the left of the value I. And this pattern 3, 1, 2, you will see many papers on the PASEP. Number of permutation according to this distribution of number of patterns will give you the Q analog inside the PASEP. So Laguerre's theory are important for orthogonal polynomial theory. I will do a whole class in next year. But this year, I will maybe make a chapter, the last chapter, or one of the last chapters, chapter 5 maybe, will be the relationship between the PASEP and orthogonal polynomial. But I cannot wait before giving this. It's you see, for each, this is the weight. The weight we put was, this is a restricted, you put some weight on the step going up, step going down on the level, and this was a restricted, because if I put weight k plus 1, 2 times k plus 1 and k plus 1, this will give me n plus 1 factorial. This is a restricted history. This gives me the Laguerre. This is giving me n factorial. But if you restrict the weight, you see, make some restriction, and this gives you some what is called the moments. I will define it in the end of the class. Of the course. The moment gives you a classical orthogonal polynomial appear. So everything to prove that this classical orthogonal polynomial, the moments I will define in chapter 5, what is the moments. The moments appear as a sum of the weighted Laguerre history. It's, you start from this classical, this bijection with permutation. Maybe you restrict the choice, you restrict, and you put some weight, alpha, beta, q, and you get many, many moments of many orthogonal polynomials. So this is a basic bijection in the. And you can retranslate, to go back to the PASEP with operator, I can retranslate this bijection in terms of operator. So this was a PASEP, the FV bijection. So we can do exactly the same with operator. You start from this empty interval. You put the 1, this was operator A. You put the 2, this was operator K. So you have a sequence. You see, you can retranslate each of these things, putting the operator A, S, K, or J is acting. You put a certain numbers in the new interval. You create or not an interval on the left or on the right. So you can easily see that you can retranslate all this as a sequence of operator. And at the end, I put the 9, and I get n plus 1 factorial. And by the way, you see, when you see this x decomposition, at any level, for example, let's take the 8 decomposition. So you start from a permutation, start from this permutation, cancel all the letters which are less or equal to 8, and you get this pattern, you see. And these three things are exactly the same as this, you see. In each level, at each step of this bijection, you have consecutive letters which represent the blue, the red block, and you have some interval like this. These two intervals represent the blue block below, and the consecutive letters here represent the red block.
You're saying the level I from top is the I decomposition?
Yes, at each level, you take your permutation. You want to have the x level. So cancel all the letters which are bigger than x. And what you get, it's a sequence of consecutive letters plus some interval. It's exactly this sequence of blue and an interval blue. And this would be the interval. So the red would wait for the number coming in the bijection. So this is the material we need to do the augmentation of to go to alternative tableau. but I get a direct proof. Now I don't, before the giving the bijection, between, so I am going to give a bijection between Laguerre history in terms of operator and alternative tableau. But even before giving the bijection, I can give the proof, direct proof of the fact that the number of such alternative tableau is n plus 1 factorial. So I claim that if you, now I go back to my operator, D, E, J, and K, and if I take all the words of length n, apply, start with one interval. At the end, maybe you have interval followed by your black letters at the left or at the right, or maybe two black letters. I claim that the sum of all this history is n plus 1 factorial. And I claim that this came directly from the bijection between Laguerre history and permutation. And to give the proof, maybe it's better to go to the next slide. To get a proof, you see, it's a. You remember that any word. So I just repeat. I am going to prove. I'm going to give a proof of this. So we remember this fundamental lemma, normal ordering. Any word in the E and D can be written like this. So if you take any words in E and D, then there is this unique summation as alternative tableau. So now I'm going to apply to my word W, I'm going to apply this starting point here, ending point here. So if I apply this to operator EI, I claim that this is the same. Because if you apply operator S, E equals S plus K, if you apply S, then this will cancel the unique interval and you are stuck. I want at the end to have this. So you, I must keep always, I cannot apply operator S starting from this. So only way to apply E is apply operator K. So if you apply operator K to this, you delete this and add a new cell on the left. So this is doing nothing. So this is equal to this. Now if I apply operator D on the right to this, if you delete this, only way to do it, and I'm not supposed to delete, only way to do is to apply operator J. And if I apply operator J, J times, then this will be invariant. So this is equal to this, equal one. So which I can restate. So I claim that this summation, starting from only one interval, ending with one interval, give you one. So I claim this lemma. Suppose you have two operators E and D, any operator E and D, satisfying the quadratic equation and satisfying this condition. We're starting from a vector V0, ending with a vector V0, and satisfying this. And I claim the number of alternating tableaux is exactly given by this. And the proof is this, what we have seen now. Okay, now D, my operator I have defined on the alternative world, D and E satisfy, and V0 equals this, satisfy the condition of the lemma. And so I have this summation is equal to the number of alternative tableaux, and so I get the proof like this, which I can also rewrite. This is the same as rewritten like this. If you start from the empty interval with no black dot in the side, at the end, I don't know which one I will get, but this is equivalent to this. So this gives you a proof of its n plus 1 factorial without any bijection. And maybe if you remember RSK chapter, you remember we have operator U and D satisfying UD equal DU plus identity. And then there was a proof, direct proof without doing the RSK, direct proof of the fact that this is equal to this, equal to this, equal to it, equal this, equal n factorial. This was a proof of this identity, this equal n factorial, using only operator U and D, satisfying this quadratic equation, operator U and D, adding and deleting something in the Ferrer diagram, and starting from the empty, ending in the empty, and this gives you proof. So this is very analog on the PASEP and in the RSK. So the analogy is so much that now we get the bijection. So it's going to be more. So the bijection, you remember your 8 diagram explaining the commutation. So this is going to be local rule, very analog to RSK. local bijection, local rule, and then I expand all this local rule. So this is going to be really complicated, the 8 different case. And then I get a bijection between permutation and the alternative tableau. So I am not going to give you straight away this bijection because I would kill you doing this bijection. But this bijection can be transformed, can be reinterpreted, can be transformed in a certain way. And so I give you the final result. I give you the practical bijection, which comes directly from the local rule analog of the. So I give you this direct bijection, which is simple to understand. So here is a permutation. And you remember we have classified the element of a permutation in the advance, and backward, going backward, recul. So an avance is mean at x plus 1 is on the right of x. And going back, x plus 1 is on the left of x. So here is my permutation. I put in blue the advance, and in red, the backward, with the convention that the maximum element 9 is a backward. From 9, I am going to the left to infinity to get the 10. So we see the 7, for example, is an advance. 7, the 8 is on the right of it. But the 2 is a recul, going backward. The 2, the next one is 3, which is on the left. So here is your permutation. In blue, I put the advance. In red, going backward plus convention n. And a special case for the last letters, I put it in green. Don't ask why. The last letter has a special treatment. So I have four blue points, four red points. So I put all the blue points on the right here. I put all the red point on the left. And you see the intersection of this line gives you a Ferrer diagram. The blue are the column, and the red are the row. See, here there is two cells on the top row. Now there is three cells on this row. There is three cells on this row, and four cells here. And I'm going to define the exchange fusion algorithm. So you choose any pair of a blue followed by a red, like 2 and 8, and you see all these numbers are going down. They are attracted by the gravity with certain conditions. So you have still 2 and 8. They go down and they cross. They cross because they are not consecutive. Now I continue 3 and 4. I have two consecutive numbers. So they don't cross. And they are going to glue together in a single block. And because the maximum of the two elements 3 and 4 is 4, so this is a leading element, and the block will continue on the thread of the maximum. So 4 and 3, you see, they don't cross, they glue together to a single block. The block continues on the road of the maximum element. And to remember, I have glue, I put a point, blue, because the maximum was on the left. Now 7, see, so you have to look here. 7 go to the column because nobody will come from above. Because of the blue dot, nobody will go down here. 5 and 1, they are not consecutive, they can cross. So 5 fall down on the ground. What else? 9. 8 and 9. They are consecutive. So they are going to give a single block. And the 9 is the maximum element is on the right. So this gives me a block 8, 9. And to remember, the maximum was on the right part of the thread, I put a red point. And I glue them together. And now for this block and this one. Now there is a new rule. When two blocks intersect, two blocks come to a crossing. So if the rule is the following, if the two blocks can be put in a single block of all consecutive letters, each block is consecutive letters. If you can put them together in the consecutive letters, then you will glue them. If not, you will cross them, which means there is some value between the two blocks which are not inside any of the two blocks. So 4-3-2 give a single block. And again, I put a blue point because one of the block, all the value are bigger than the value of the other block. So you will see if it's coming from the left or the right, you put a blue or a red. So now these two blocks, they can cross because between 2, 3, 4, and 8, 9, there is some value. The two blocks cannot be.
So what is the condition for crossing?
Two blocks can cross, like this one, if gluing them together doesn't give you a set of consecutive letters, which means that between the block 2, 3, 4 and the block 8, 9, there exists some value outside of the block. That is 5, 6, 7 are between the value of the two blocks, but they are not in the block. So you glue them only if. Yes, question? Yes.
What if 2 came from the left and 4, 3 from the right?
4, 3 from the right?
Here, 4, 3 came from the left and
yes.
2 from the right.
Yes.
But what if 2 came from the left and 4, 3 from the right? Would you glue them or?
But this was the case, no, it's a. Yes.
You glue them, but it goes the other way.
Here, 4, 3 come from the left, 2 come from the right, so I glue them.
Yeah, that's okay. Huh? But what if 2 were to come from the left and 4, 3 on the right, what would you do?
Yes, I would glue them also and put a red point instead.
And then go on the right.
And then go. And the rule is that recursively you can show that all the letters of one block are bigger than all the letters of the other block. After a certain number of operations, I don't claim that all the ten blocks are in decreasing or like this special case or increasing order. The value can be, when you glue many, many blocks, then the value is not necessarily totally decreasing or totally increasing inside. But you can glue them if all the value of one all the value of one block will be bigger than all the value of the other block. So you know to put a blue or red point, and you glue them when putting them in the single block. You don't. In fact, I put them in total order, but you can mix them inside the block. Putting them in a single block make a set of consecutive values. So here it's I can glue them, but here I can I cross them because there is some value between 2, 3, 4, and 8, 9. So you see again, this one is going to glue with this. The bigger value are on the left, so this gives me a blue point. So this can, now the 7, you see 7 can glue with 8, 9. The bigger value comes from the right. So I put a red dot. And the rule is that the block follows the thread, the column of the biggest, the dominating block, block of all the value bigger than the other one. You glue them, and then you fall down on the ground. The 6, so you see the 6 is not interacting with anybody. 6 start from this and it's following along. The six was above here, but you can make it falling down on the ground immediately. And then I claim that you can forget the block. Here I claim that I have a alternative tableau. The blue cells are columns of the tableau, so this is the first column, and I have a red point. Second column, I have 4 cells with 3 blue, and the third column is this one, and this one. So I have an alternative tableau, and I claim that you can totally forget what is on the ground, and I claim that this is a bijection. I claim that if you know the alternative tableau, I can go back to the permutation. So I do the reverse algorithm. So start from an alternative tableau with this blue cell and blue column, blue thread, and this. So this is an alternative tableau of size n. I am working with size n plus 1. I put an extra green column. Alternative tableau means that on the left of any blue cell, there is nothing. On the left, there is nothing. So I can delete. In fact, alternative tableau is this, written in this way of. This is. You understand? what I have done. This is an alternative tableau written with a blue and red column as a thread with a crossing inside the Fernandel diagram. Because the definition of the alternative tableau and deleting this part of the thread, I get this. I get, there is many trees like this in India. See, this is a tree, like a frangipane. And, in fact, you have a binary tree, you have a Catalan tree behind this. Separate, you see, the blue and thread. If you separate them, you get this. If you don't involve with the crossing, you separating it, but to get a tree, you have to add this. So underlying my alternative tableau, there is a binary tree contained by Catalan number. Underlying this, there is a, so this binary tree with some crossing, you go from Catalan number to permutation. So everybody in India knows that this is permutation. The number of such trees, this binary tree where the branches can, by perspective, by projection, can cross, this is permutation. And I do the reverse bijection. So you start from this. I have to construct the bijection. I have to go back. The blocks which are on the ground, I have to go back on the... So first, I have to put the block. Some blocks fall down on the ground. The blocks are consecutive letters. The order of the letter does not count. So first, I am going to label... I have some blue trees, and I have some red trees. So I am going to label, totally order the blue trees by the root from left to right. And
how do you get this from a tableau?
From a tableau?
Yeah.
Oh, it's a, how do I get this from a tableau? See, I have done this. It's a, start from this tableau. This tableau, you can get, see the blue are the column. So the tableau is just restricted to this, you see. But you can extend in a tableau this red part. You can extend it, the row. You can extend the column too. So from a tableau, you get this picture easily.
So the intersections are each cells?
Yes, intersection are each cell. Okay. See the first column, there is... So there is four cells which correspond to this empty, the red and this. So this is the first column, and this is this first column here. Second column, each intersection is a cell of the Ferrer. Here the column is only two elements, column is one element. And each row, you see, this is the top row, two elements. Next row, this is the row with three elements, the second row, and this is the first row with four elements. So you get your Ferrer, it just, I like to put a Ferrer like this because it's, balls are falling on the ground and everything, but you can, of course, this algorithm, you can rewrite it directly on the Ferrer. And then you extend the thread with the blue and the red. So you extend the, just extend the picture of the blue column and the red row. So from the Ferrer, you have an equivalent picture like this. And because it's an alternative tableau, you take off all this part of the... I am, so I take off part of the row, and I take off part of the column. Everything which is the left of the blue cell, everything below a red cell. And I get this. And now I define the reverse bijection. So first, you label the blue tree from left to right. See the first one, second one, and then I will order, the next tree will be the red one from right to left. Suppose there is many red trees, many blue trees. You first order the blue from left to right, and then the red from right to left. So you get a total order on the whole set of trees, the blue and the red. So first tree, second tree, third tree. So next step, I take the first tree. You look above, how many leaves look above the tree? There is four leaves corresponding the four black dog. Just by the mind, imagine you take off these trees This will be a binary tree with an added tail at the root, but above there is four leaves. So I'm going to put four elements here, which are in disorder. They are not, so it's four elements, 1, 2, 3, 4. There's no order for the moment, because there is four leaves above this, this the binary tree, which can, yes?
Before this step, what was the step? What did you?
Before the step? No. No, I take the first, I have all totally ordered my trees. So this is the first tree, the first one. This is the second one, and this is the tree number three.
Why is the middle one the first one?
That's the rule. I give an order on the tree, 1, 2, 3. I define an order. First, I'm going to order the blue tree. I order the blue tree from left to right. And once you have finished to order totally the blue tree, I continue with the red trees, but now from right to left. So this gives me a total order on the blue and the red together. Now I take the first tree. So as a binary tree, you look above. But you imagine you take this tree, and this tree has four leaves. So the rule, I put 1, 2, 3, 4. On the ground. This was the block you get in the bijection. The block falling down, a block of consecutive letters. Maybe they are in a certain order, but what is important, there is no order on my letter here on the block. I don't know in which order I'm going to put, but I put 1, 2, 3, 4. Then I take the next tree, which are only one leaf. It's not a binary tree. It's a binary tree with a tail. So it's reduced to the tail. So I put the next one. I put one element. It's 5. Now I don't go immediately to the red tree. I put an extra 6. Ah, I get it. It's n+1, it's not n. An extra 6. Then I go to the red trees. So the red trees, there is 3 leaves. And I put 7, 8, 9. And it's finished. I have no more red trees. So this is the rule to put your block on the ground. Each block, the letters are disordered. There is no total order in the letters. Now the blocks are going backward. They are going to be lifted up. And let's take this block. So you lift it up. Ah, a red point means the block is going to be split in two different blocks. So the rule, of course, because here there is one leaf, so you have to put one block with one letters. And here, I will put here a block with two letters. So the letter will be consecutive. So we have to split this in two parts. One side, one letters. Other side, two letters. But because it's a red point, all the maximum letters must go to the right. So I have to split just here between 7 and 8. 8 and 9 has to go here. And 7 has to go here because it's red. If it was blue, it would be, so the maximum letter would go here. So there will be only the 9 if it was a blue. And here, I need to go a block of 2 letters, which are less. So it would be 7, 8 would be here, and 9 would be here. So you see, when you split the block, it's different splitting according to the color of the blue or the red. And then you can go up. Now I have to again to split here, 8, 9. So 9 go to the right. And I finish with this tree. You can take it in any order. I can begin with that. It's independent. In each tree, it's independent. What happened is independent. Because of the crossing doesn't count. You can imagine the tree putting them together apart to form a Catalan tree, and it would be the same. So 1, 2, 3, 4.
But here, how do you know how to split? Is it 1 and 3, 2 and 2?
So to split? So let's do this here again. So you look the 2, 3 above. So on the left, there is 3 leaves. So you know the number. The left block must be 3 elements. The right block must be 1 element. So you count the leaves. So you know the cardinality of each block. Now how to put to divide in three and one of three consecutive letters. So there is two possibilities. You can put in one block one, two, three, and the other four. Or you can put one in one block and two, three, four on the other one. So it's two different ways to split, knowing the cardinality and knowing that this block must be consecutive letters. So the color gives you which possibility. So here, the maximum value must go on the left. So you have to put three maximum values on the left, and then you cut two, three, four, and one. And again, two, three, four. So I have to cut two maximum values on the left. It's blue. So it's maybe three, four, and two. And then four. And you see the six remain alone, but it does not interact with anybody, but it's very important to put this special value. It's maybe strange for you, but and then the six go up also. And then you get the permutation. So this direct bijection, which is very visual with block falling down. This is why I put the Fourier diagram like this, because I like the gravity and going up and down. But you can rewrite this in terms of Fourier diagram directly on the row and column. So I claim that this bijection, direct bijection, is exactly what you get by applying the commutation local rule coming from the A diagram of the commutation with the four operator. So a variation of the, before starting, a variation of this exchange delete algorithm. A variation is to, instead of keeping all the block, like the same algorithm, but instead of keeping all the block, when you cross like this, 4-3, you keep the maximum element. You don't take the whole block. So this is called exchange fusion, no, exchange delete algorithm. I exchange, sometimes I exchange, sometimes I delete. So for example, 4-2, the block 4-2, I will keep the maximum element. 5-1 is, so I claim that these two algorithms are exactly equivalent. What you do in one algorithm, keeping the block, what you do on deleting element, keeping the maximum element of the block, what remains, the behavior is exactly the same. 8-9, so you keep the 9, keep the maximum, and the maximum follows the road. So he has killed all the minimum element. Instead of keeping everybody, all the family in the block, you go down with single letters. So 4 and 2. It's important. Why is 2 is disappearing? They are not consecutive. It's because they are consecutive in the subword. If you take all the value, 1, 2, 3, so take the minimum 1, the 2, the next one is 4. So if you totally order what remains, 1 and 4 are consecutive. 2 and 4 are consecutive. So the 2 is disappeared and the maximum take. So 4 and 9, they cross. Now 1 and 4, see, there's nobody between 1 and 4, so the 1 are going to disappear. And 7 and 9, the 8 is not taking. So 7 and 9 are going to glue together. And but this is important because to show the equivalence coming from the representation, I need this bijection I show you, like this, a variation of the exchange fusion as exchange delete is equivalent to a bijection which was given before by Sylvie Cortel and Philippe Nadeau. It's equivalent, but you have to work with another kind of tableau, permutation tableau, which are in bijection in the alternative tableau. So if you translate the bijection in terms of permutation tableau, if you do some maybe complementary symmetry, you have to do a little. So the two bijections are the same. So you can inverse this. Or it's to get the reverse, maybe I go faster. For example, you have to climb up. So you don't need the tree. To do the reverse, this reverse algorithm, you don't need the tree. You just go up. Going left and right when there is a blue. So here the value. So now there's a problem because. See, when I. Here's a one. The one came from a block of two consecutive letters, and the biggest was on the left. So I introduce, I add a new biggest value, which is 2, but 2 already appear here. So I should add 1.5. I have to add another value just immediately consecutive to the one which is bigger than. So I put a 2, and then I have to shift all the value bigger than 2, 3, 4, 5. So you see, each time, so you can go like this. You climb again up, but each time you are adding a value bigger to make a block, then all the value bigger are shifted by 1. For example, I have added 3 here. I have added a block 2, 3. So all the value, I shift all the value bigger than 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, maybe you are becoming to be tired, but.
This is messier because you keep updating.
Yes, you update everything. Each time you are going up, you create a new block of consecutive letters. I am adding a letter just.
And then more close to this ball. Right?
Yes. I need this to show the equivalence with representation theory. So I have a slight problem because I should finish this I cannot start again next lecture because all this material you have in mind and I should finish. So maybe we'll overlap 5-10 minutes if you allow me to finish. But now I have to show the commutation diagram bijection, the bijection coming from the philosophy of the RSK. So here are the 4 equations. I have to introduce the identity operator. So in fact, there is 6 generators with 8 equations. So the local rule, the commutation diagram, I have to, so this gives you the local rule, but I have to change slightly because there is identity operator, vertical horizontal identity, which was given by this. So I want to really to make the analog of RSK with commutation diagram. So I am going to change this diagram which explains, for example, this algebraic equation. I have to change them like a commutation diagram. So it's exactly the same. You see, this diagram is the same as this one. AS equal SA is a special case. And I transform this exactly the same in a commutation diagram. And you see, I put some yellow arrow, which means I am applying the operator A on this position. Or here, I have a sequence of white and blue and black ball. And this means, so the state of this local rule is a sequence of white and interval and black. It's identity web and plus the green arrow, which tell you where did I apply the operator. So this is operator S, which was applied in this cell. So this is not the same as RSK, because RSK, if you know the two Ferrer, if you add a new cell in a Ferrer, you don't need to know where did I put the cell, because knowing the two Ferrer, you know immediately where did you put the cell. But here, if you I give you this and this, you don't know where I apply the. So in this commutation diagram, analog to Ferrer local rule, it's additive word plus the position in green, the yellow, the green arrow where you act. And now you see this term, which was SA equal J. SA equal, no, this is AS equal. So this corresponds to this. This term, which corresponds to this term, AS equal J, this is this diagram. I transform this into this diagram, you see. And then the new thing, I introduce the identity operator. So this term, in fact, is corresponds to this term, identity operator with J, which corresponds to this identity operator. And you see now this term comes from the gluing of 2 black balls into 1. And you see the blue cell is appearing. And here too, I have two black dots gluing in 1, which give me this term K. So K, you have to put in K multiplied by identity operator. And this corresponds to a red cell. So each time all the possible rule, each time there's a gluing of something, a blue or a red cell will appear. And depending the way it was gluing, with the interval cell on the left or on the right. So believe me, all this is going to be translated into local commutation diagram. It's the same, but sometimes there is identity operator and which correspond to a blue or a red. So this is also going to be this, and this is going to be this. And so this is 8 possible case of local rule plus the trivial local rule you will get from this. And then knowing all this local rule, I do the analog of RSK. Commutation. So RSK, you remember when you have the, you have to do commutation diagram in RSK, you have to find the bijection between this triple, it was U and D, with the position of the, where do you apply U, the position where do you apply mu, and there was a bijection with this, union this, where there was again, there was this, with maybe there was no point of the permutation, maybe there was a point of the permutation. So there was a bijection between what I call commutation diagram, this diagram, union of this diagram or this one. So I'm going to do exactly the same. My commutation diagram will be all the diagram I showed you before, all these possible diagram here. So this is a commutation diagram. And sometimes there is no point. Sometimes we see the crossing. Sometimes there's a blue point. Sometimes there is a red point. So there is, for example, here, there is a bijection between this triple here and this triple here plus the knowledge of the blue point. So exactly the same spirit as RSK. You make a bijection of the commutation diagram, which explains the commutativity of the passep algebra with these 4 operators. And this bijection, this explanation in a single cell, is propagated on the grid and give you the whole bijection, same as in RSK. Think of RSK, you just replace commutation diagram of RSK with this commutation diagram more complicated, and you get exactly the same spirit, you get the bijection. So for example, start with the permutation. Permutation gives you, I'm going to show you the bijection. From a permutation, I will get an additive tableau by working on this commutation diagram bijection. So the permutation gives you a Laguerre history, as we have seen. From the permutation, you can reconstruct the whole sequence like this, with a sequence of operator A, K, J, A, et cetera, et cetera. So you put A and A and J will be horizontal edges. S and K will be, so you, Laguerre history is going to be put in this diagram. So this is the starting point, you see the permutation with the Laguerre history. So now you don't need the, I need only the sequence. I need the sequence of this diagram, and now apply the commutation rule. So there's 8 different cases, so just apply. So you see, I have my green edges, which tell me in which, and I apply all this relation, the commutation rule, which explains the commutation relation. So for example, if you do this, look at the commutation rule here, and then the bijectively, this will give you this. So just apply, believe me, if you apply the commutation rule in any order, so here I will get this. And here I will get a blue point. I will get this will introduce, because there is a gluing of 2 black balls somewhere. So I will get the J, the I operator, and the blue. So believe me, it's if I apply all my commutation rule, I will get this nice picture, you see. So below this picture, there is an additive tableau. Each vertex of the Ferrer is an alternative word, plus some green edges to say, where did you act A, K, S, or J, or K? And so you get this. So this is a bijection. It's another bijection between which I came from the representation theory. This is another bijection, which from a permutation, I get a Laguerre history. Laguerre history, I put it on the border of the Ferrer diagram. I apply all my commutation rule and like in RSK, and I get a whole tableau, and I delete everything. I keep just the white cell, the blue cell, and the red cell, and I get alternative tableau, and I claim that this is a bijection. It's because the commutation rule are reversible. Take an alternative tableau like this. So you know, when I have alternative tableau, I can all the cells which are neither blue, neither red, not at the left of a blue, not at below a red, I can put, this is a crossing, the Q, and you can put the identity operator because there is some brown line. If you remember the brown line below a red, the brown line on the left of the blue, I have the identity operator. Now I claim here I have KK only. I cannot have S because I am starting with the empty, like for Ferrer diagram in RSK, we are starting with the empty Ferrer. Here I am starting with a single interval, and at the end, I must have only a single interval. Maybe some black dot will appear. At the end, a single interval in the world, at the beginning, a single interval. So you cannot apply S here. If you apply S, you kill this single interval, and you will never finish with the black with this. So you have to keep always at least a single interval. So you only have operator K, which keep invariant this picture. Yeah. Each time you had a new element in the interval, and you had a new black point on the. No, only here you can apply J, because if we are applying A, this will create two new. And to cancel this, if you create two new interval, when you go in horizontally, you can only apply A or J. So this new interval created will never be able to cancel them. Because going horizontally, you cannot apply the S operator. So you are forced to apply only J, and this gives you this. In fact, what I am saying, only applying K in J, you remember the proof that the number of alternative tableau was n factorial without using any bijection. I was applying this argument. So now you can start the commutation rule. You can read them in a reverse way. Like this. And then you just keep in mind what you have at the border, and you have a Laguerre history, which is this, which gives you the permutation. So now I have two different, totally different bijections. The one coming, I explain here, coming from representation theory of the Passep algebra, the one with the ball falling down or going up. So they are totally different. What is the relationship between these two? This is a local algorithm. Give me a permutation tau. The first bijection by exchange fusion or exchange delete was this one. What is the relationship between sigma and tau? The relation is sigma equal tau minus one. Yes, the inverse. And I will finish this long class with an idea of the proof. I cannot stop because if I have to do this next time, I have half an hour to remind you everything. So let's start with this. This bijection was with the Laguerre history with the commutation rule. Take the inverse. It's not exactly the same as I was in the example I gave with the ball falling down, but let's do it again. Take the inverse. So I put, instead of putting with the blue and red thread, I put it on the Ferrer diagram, and then I do the exchange. Instead of doing the exchange fusion algorithm, I will do the exchange delete. It's more convenient to show the equivalence. I will do the exchange delete with a slight variation. Instead of keeping the maximum, I will keep the minimum. Here, see, I will keep. I am going to exchange delete 2 and 1. Keep the one. But the one has to go here. He has to follow the root of the maximum. So the one kills so the maximum disappeared, and the minimum will follow the root of the. So this is another variation of the. So you exchange or you delete and you keep the minimum. The minimum keeps the way of the where the maximum was supposed to go. Okay, and I get this. So I claim that this was inverse. I have the bijection, and this was inverse bijection, and I claim that this is the permutation. This is inverse. You have seen the both algorithm for both permutation. I claim that these are the same. And I will finish with this visual proof. You see, so this is on one side, the Laguerre history and the commutation rule with the permutation here. On the other side, is going to be the inverse permutation with the exchange delete algorithm. And the two algorithm, you can make the two algorithm in parallel. And each time, so here you see when I have done this, in the Laguerre, so this is a Laguerre history. And when you are going to follow all this diagram computation here, this is the value of the permutation, 1, 2, 3. So here is 1 and 2. So in the next step, this corresponds exchanging 1 and 2. Because if I have done the commutation relation, if I follow this, this is a new Laguerre history, which corresponds to the permutation exchanging 1 and 2. And here you see, I am exchanging the first and second value. The 1 and 2 is the permutation, the value corresponds to the indices in the inverse. So I am exchanging 2 and 9. Yeah? So now I am exchanging 3 and 4. And here I am the 3 and. I am exchanging 3 and 4. Yes, here, in this permutation. So 3 and 4. The third. This is the third and value. The fourth value. I am exchanging 1 and 7. So for the moment, it's easy. Now I have a blue. So which means that this was 1, 2, 3. So you see two. This became 2, 3, but 2 is identity operator. So the Laguerre history means that 2 disappeared. So this is a partial Laguerre history on a one less element. 2 disappeared, and here in the blue, the 2 disappeared also. This is important to have fixed the minimum, keeping the minimum between 2 and 1. I keep the minimum, and 2 disappeared. And what happened here is I am exchanging. In the exchange process, you can exchange 2 values, but if they are consecutive, here, you don't exchange, one of them is going to disappear. And this happened exactly here also. I have 2 consecutive values, but the values are x and x plus 1. So you see, in both cases, there is 2 consecutive values in both cases, and one is x, one is x plus 1. So in that case, on both sides, a blue or a red point disappears, something is going to disappear. And what disappeared, you have to show that both sides is equivalent. So you continue, see, you can convince yourself. There is maybe a slight, because sometimes you see the, oh, it's, sometimes when the identity is here, the identity 6 and empty cell, 6 is going to become 5, is because 6, I have 5, 6. So 5 was the identity operator. So it is, was not inside the Laguerre history, but when I make the switch, 5 becomes inside the Laguerre history, the 6. So here, this corresponds to the Laguerre history. The 6 is going to become a 5, and this will keep it. But you can convince yourself that in both sides are exactly equivalent. And what I am doing is isomorphic. So this is an idea of the proof of this is the same bijection. So the philosophy, you see, of course, we have from the representation theory of the Passep algebra, we have done this. We have introduced Laguerre history, we have introduced representation theory, and doing exactly the same as RSK in a maybe much more complicated way. We have a bijection analog with commutation rule. And this bijection, by taking the inverse permutation, is going back to a classical bijection equivalent to Cortel-Nadeau. So, but it's maybe good for the mind to know that this bijection, direct bijection you can construct, can be obtained also in a complicated way by applying the general idea. So the philosophy is maybe for open problems like adjacent matrices to apply the general idea to get something very, very awful, complicated with commutation rule. And then we transform this in a direct way that maybe you cannot obtain directly.
But and, you still have an algorithm.
Yes, there is an algorithm. And so next time I will give you the second bijection, which explains directly. It's another bijection with trees and totally different philosophy. And but I finish the first bijection and the analog of RSK for additive tableau. Okay, thank you.